students, today we'll be defining communication objectives. At the end of this session, you should be able to define communication, cite the process, elements, and channels of communication, enumerate the types of communication, cite the levels of communication, enumerate factors that affect communication, list the barriers of communication, identify the techniques that enable an effective communication. Dear students, in this session, we are going to discuss the various aspects of communication function. We shall discuss the process, elements, channels, types, levels, barriers, and techniques that enable a person to carry out an effective communication. Let's get on to the introduction. Have you seen bees communicating way home, direction to nectar, etc.? Examples of non-verbal communication include a smile, wink, or gestures. All of these communicate a message without the use of oral or written language. If you do not say a word, your silence can communicate in a non-verbal way. When most people think of successful business people, they think of those who can make sales and sign accounts, have good finance skills, and attention to skills and display stellar record-keeping abilities. However, some of the most important skills that a business person can have are communication skills. Without communicating the intended learning outcomes and contents effectively to the learners, learning cannot take place. So, to deliver effective teaching, a farmer, teacher must be a good communicator, which requires the understanding of process and techniques of communication. Communication. Communication is the activity of conveying information. It has been derived from the Latin word communis, which means to share. Communication requires a sender, a message, and an intended recipient. However, the receiver needs not to be present or be aware of the sender's intent to communicate at the time of communication. Thus, communication can occur across vast distances in time and space. Communication is part and parcel of our day-to-day professional as well as social life. It is interwoven in all agricultural activities and is an inseparable part of agribusiness. The farmer has to communicate crop information and other facts to the members of organization. Similarly, he has to communicate with other farmers while assessing, planning, implementing, and evaluating cropping. Communication can be defined as the exchange of opinion, ideas, information, facts, feelings, and values between two or more persons, that is, senders and receivers, with the help of some channels to accomplish the desired purpose. Westall, in the year 1995, defined communication as the exchange of meanings between and among individuals through a shared system of symbols, verbal and non-verbal, that have the same meaning for both the sender and the receiver of the message. Murphy and Hildebrandt defined communication as a process of transmitting and receiving verbal and non-verbal messages that produce a response. Joseph A. DeVito mentioned that communication refers to the act by one or more persons of sending and receiving messages that are distorted by noise, occur within a context, and have some effect and provide some opportunity for a feedback. Communication is a cyclic process that involves initiation, transmission, and reception of information. The reception of information is followed by the feedback, which in turn can repeat the cycle of communication. Process, elements, and channels of communication. Communication is a cyclic process that starts with the sender feels that there is a need to communicate with the receiver for a particular reason or a purpose. The sender creates a message either in written or in verbal or in non-verbal form. The message is dispatched to the receiver with the help of channels of communication. The receiver takes the delivery of the message and then provides a feedback to the sender. The sender gets back the feedback and determines whether the receiver has received the same message and meaning that the sender had intended to communicate with him. If the sender feels that the receiver has not received the same message and meaning, he or she again initiates the cycle of communication. The elements of communication are sender, message, channel of communication, receiver, Feedback. Sender. The sender is the person who initiates the process of communication. Whenever the sender feels that there is a need to communicate some information to the other person, which is the receiver, he or she starts the process of communication. The sender must be aware of the purpose of the communication and the receiver's ability to understand the message in terms of language, interest, etc. Message. The message is created by the sender to convey the information, facts or opinion to the receiver. While creating a message, the sender should take care of words, language and meaning of the message if message is to be communicated in verbal or written form, or he or she should take care of body language and facial expression if the message is to be communicated in non-verbal form, along with the abilities and professional competencies of the receiver. Channels of communication. Communication channels are the medium through which the message is communicated to the receiver. Channels of communication play an important role in the process of communication. If the sender selects an appropriate medium or channel of communication, there are more chances that the receiver will receive the same message, or else there are chances that the message may get distorted. Receiver. The receiver is the person who receives the message. The receiver may be a single person or a group of persons. The receiver understands the meaning of the message and provides feedback to the sender. The receiver should have the same language ability, comprehension, and cultural background as the sender. If not, it may lead to distorted misunderstanding of the meaning of the message by the receiver. Feedback. It is the most crucial element of communication. It is provided by the receiver to the sender. Receiving feedback is important for the sender to know that the receiver has received the message and interpreted the meaning of the message in the desired way. Without feedback, the process of communication cannot be complete. Now let's get on to the types of communication. Communication may be different types depending upon the context in which the term communication is used. The most important types of communication are verbal communication. When the sender conveys information, facts and opinion, either verbally or in writing, to the receiver using different channels of communication, it is known as verbal communication. The sender should select appropriate words and language to communicate the message to the receiver. Non-verbal communication. It takes place without the use of words. It involves the unconscious mind acting out emotions related to the verbal content, the situation, and the environment. The sender uses the body language, facial expressions, hand movements, eye movements, etc. to convey the feelings, emotions and other information to the receiver. This type of communication can be useful when both the sender and the receiver don't have an understanding of a common language. This technique is especially useful when you are dealing with a client who is deaf and dumb. Non-verbal communication may include vocal cues, gestures, posture, physical appearance, distance or spatial territory, position or posture, touch, facial expressions, formal communication. It is a type of communication which is used in the context of organization where a large group of employees work together to accomplish goals of an organization. Formal communications usually take place in the form of written communication, which follows the lines of authority or scalar chain of command. Informal communication. It refers to the gossip or informal talks that take place among the various groups of people working in an organization that don't follow organizational line of authority or hierarchy. Levels of communication. Levels of communication are determined on the basis of number of people involved in the process of communication as well as on the purpose of communication. These levels of communication are as follows. Intrapersonal communication. It refers to communication with the self. It may be silent or verbal type of communication. Intrapersonal type of communication approximates with the thinking process in which the person consciously sends information to himself or herself in order to analyze a situation. This communication strategy is particularly useful when someone has to make important life decisions or is facing a conflicting situation. Interpersonal communication. This refers to one-to-one interaction between two persons that often occurs face-to-face. The purpose of interpersonal communication is to share information, opinion, ideas, and so on. Interpersonal communication technologies. Transpersonal communication occurs within a person's spiritual domain. The purpose of transpersonal communication is to realize selfhood, enhance spirituality, and answer the questions that are spiritual in nature. Small group communication is a type or level of communication which takes place within a small group. The purpose of small group communication is to communicate information that is of common interest to group members, or sometimes to know the opinions of group members to arrive at a decision. Public communication occurs between a large group of people or lay persons with a vast difference in number of factors, example, socioeconomic status, literacy level, occupation, and habitat. This requires special communication skills as the group is very large and so many differences among the group members as described earlier. There is a need to maintain different types of eye contact with the public, gestures and voices, and media materials should be used to communicate messages effectively. Social communication takes place in the social context. Being a social animal, human beings establish relationships with other people to accomplish several purposes throughout their lifespan. In order to keep these social relations alive and being social, one has to communicate with others. Good morning. How are you? How are children? This type of communication is one's social obligation to communicate within his or her social group to which he or she belongs. Factors influencing communication. There are certain factors that influence the process of communication. Let's get to know them in detail. Attitude. Attitude is referred to the internal predisposition of a person to act in a certain way toward a situation. The attitude of a person toward the given situation is influenced by peers, parents, environment, life experiences, perception, and intellectual process. A person may have the attitude of accepting, prejudiced, judgmental, negative, open and close, etc. A person with negative attitude may respond with, "I am sure it is of no use. It will not work ultimately." On the other hand, a person with positive attitude will reply, "Come on guys, let's try it. We have nothing to lose." Socio-cultural background. Various cultures and ethnic groups display different communication patterns. For example, people of French or Italian heritage often are gregarious and talkative and willing to share thoughts and feelings. People from Southeast Asian countries such as Thailand or Laos are quiet and reserved. They appear stoic and reluctant to discuss personal feelings with persons outside their families. Past experiences. Previous positive or negative experiences influence one's ability to communicate. For example, teenagers who've been criticized by their parents, whenever attempting to express any feelings, may develop a poor self-image and feel that their opinions are not worthwhile. As a result, they may avoid interacting with others, become indecisive when asked to give an opinion, or agree with others to avoid what they perceive to be criticism or confrontation, or non-assertive. Knowledge of subject matter. A person who is well-educated or knowledgeable about certain topics may communicate with others at a high level of understanding. The receiver, who is relatively less knowledgeable of the topic under discussion, may be unable to comprehend the message or consider the sender to be an expert. As a result of this misperception, the receiver may neglect to ask questions and may not receive the correct information. Ability to relate with others. Some people are natural-born talkers who claim to have never met a stranger. Others may possess an intuitive trait that enables them to say the right thing at the right time and relate well to people. "I feel so comfortable talking with her. She's so easy to relate to, and I could talk to him for hours," are just a few comments made about people who have the ability to relate well with others. These persons are considered as good communicators. Interpersonal perception. Our mental processes by which intellectual, sensory, and emotional data are reorganized logically and meaningfully which determine how we perceive others. Inattentiveness, disinterest, or lack of use of one's senses during communication can result in distorted perceptions of others. Satir, in the year 1995, warns of looking without seeing, listening without hearing, touching without feeling, moving without awareness, and speaking without meaning. Environmental factors. Environmental factors such as time, place, number of people present, and the noise level can influence communication between people in that particular surrounding. Timing is important during a conversation. A very well-timed response catches the attention of others. The place in which communication occurs, as well as the number of people present and noise level, has a definite influence on interactions among people. Now let's see the barriers of communication. Communication plays a very important role in developing a relationship. It can also affect the relationship among family members or management in any institute. More specifically, communication influences the effectiveness of instruction, performance, evaluation, and handling of discipline problems. Communication should be straightforward. What can make it complex, difficult, and frustrating are the barriers. Some barriers of communication are physiological barrier. These are related with the limitations of the human body and the human mind, like memory, attention, and perception. Physiological barriers may result from individual's personal discomfort caused by ill health, poor eyesight, or hearing difficulties. Physical and environmental distractions. Physical distractions are the physical things that get in the way of communication. Examples of such things include the telephone, an uncomfortable meeting place, and noise. These physical distractions are common in hospital setting. If the telephone rings, the usual human tendency will be to answer it, even if the caller is interrupting a very important or even delicate conversation. Similarly, if someone has personal problems, such as worries and stress about a chronic illness, it may impinge his or her communication with others. Social barriers. Social barriers to communication include the social psychological phenomena of conformity, a process in which the norms, values, and behaviors of an individual begin to follow those of the wider group. Social factors such as age, gender, socioeconomic status, and marital status may act as a barrier to communicate in certain situations. Cultural barriers. Culture shapes the way we think and behave. It can be seen as both shaping and being shaped by our established patterns of communication. Cultural barrier to communication often arises when individuals in one social group have developed different norms, values, or behaviors to individuals associated with another group. Cultural difference leads to difference in interest, knowledge, value, and tradition. Therefore, people of different cultures will experience these culture factors as a barrier to communicate with each other. Semantic barrier. Language, jargon, slang, etc. are some of the semantic barriers. Different languages across different regions represent a national barrier to communication, which is particularly important for migrating nurses. Use of jargon and slang also act as barrier to communication. Linguistic barriers. Individual linguistic ability may sometimes become a barrier to communication. The use of difficult or inappropriate words in communication can prevent the people from understanding the message. Poorly explained or misunderstood messages can also result in confusion. The linguistic differences between the people can also lead to communication breakdown. The same word may mean differently to different individuals. Facilitating communication. The following general guidelines may be helpful to facilitate communication. Have a positive attitude about communication. Defensiveness interferes with communication. Work at improving communication skills. The communication model and discussion of barriers to communication provide the necessary knowledge to improve communication. This increased awareness of the potential for improving communication is the first step to better communication. Include communication as a skill to be evaluated along with all other nursing skills for undergraduates. Make communication goal-oriented. Relational goals come first and pave the way for other goals. When the sender and the receiver have a good relationship, they are much more likely to accomplish their communication goals. Experiment with communication alternatives. What works with one person may not work well with another. Use diverse communication channels, listening and feedback techniques. Accept the reality of miscommunication. The best communicators fail to have perfect communication. They accept miscommunication and work to minimize its negative impacts. Use of simple and clear words should be emphasized. Use of ambiguous words and jargons should be avoided. Noise is the main communication barrier in most of the healthcare settings, which must be handled on priority basis. It is essential to identify and eliminate the source of noise. Listen attentively and carefully. There is a difference between listening and hearing. Active listening means hearing with the proper understanding of the message. By asking questions, the speaker can ensure whether his or her message is understood or not by the receiver in the same manner as intended by him. The managers should know how to prioritize their work. They should not overload themselves with the work, should spend quality time with their subordinates, and should listen to their problems and feedbacks actively. There are 6 C's of effective communication, which are both applicable to written as well as oral communication. They are as follows. Complete. The message must be complete in all respect and should convey all facts required by the receiver. Incompleteness of the message may lead to misunderstanding or incomplete understanding and confusion between the sender and the receiver. It is the responsibility of the sender to make sure before mailing the message that the provided information in the message is complete as per the purpose of the communication. Clear. Clarity in communication makes understanding easier and enhances the meaning of a message. A clear message uses exact, appropriate, and concrete words and avoids ambiguous words. Correctness. Correctness in communication implies that there are no grammatical and spelling errors in communication. Concise. Conciseness means eliminating wordiness and communicating what you want to convey in least possible words without foregoing the other C's of communication. Conciseness is necessary for effective communication. Consideration. Consideration implies stepping into the shoes of the others. Effective communication must take the receiver or receivers into consideration, that is the audience viewpoints, backgrounds, mindset, educational level, etc. The sender should make an attempt to understand the audience, their requirements, emotions, as well as problems. Ensure that the self-respect of the audience is maintained and their emotions are not hurt. Courtesy. Courtesy in message implies that the message should show the sender's expression as well as respect to the receiver. The sender of the message should be sincerely polite, judicious, reflective, and enthusiastic. Conclusion. This session has enabled you to know what is communication, process, elements and channels of communication, types of communication, levels of communication, factors affecting communication, barriers to communication, and techniques for effective communication. Communication is a skill that can be learned in the same way as other farming skills. Indeed, it will require some training to learn and master the skill. Communication can be defined as exchange of opinion, ideas, information, facts, feelings and value between two or more persons, which is the sender and the receiver or the receivers, with the help of variety of channels to accomplish the desired purpose. The elements of communication are sender, message and channels of communication, receiver and feedback. The important types of communication are verbal, non-verbal, formal and informal. Levels of communication include intrapersonal, interpersonal, transpersonal, small group, and public. Barriers of communication can be categorized into psychological, sociocultural, semantic, linguistic capacity, physical illness, technology failure, environmental, and organizational. By going through this session, we got to know that to perform an effective communication, the message should be clear, concrete, concise and correct. Thank you.